Once again, welcome to our all-day movie workshop. I'm Peter, I'm your host. And yeah, I can just let everybody know the flow of the day, as per usual. So we're going to start with the movie with David. He's going to give a commentary. And then afterwards, we have a 10-minute break. You can submit your questions and your prayers. And then we'll come back for a closing Q&A session with David, or he just answer the questions that have been submitted. And so we have David with us in the studio here in Mexico. And so I'm going to pass it over to him now.
Hi, everyone. Welcome. You're in for a big treat today. Everyone is in for a huge, huge treat. This is like a birthday present for you from Jesus. But the birthday for Jesus is to be reborn again. You, as he told Nicodemus 2,000 years ago, when Nicodemus was saying, "What do you mean by I have to be born again? Do I have to enter my mother's womb again?" Jesus says, "No, no, no. You know, to be born again, you are born again in spirit. You are born again in the present moment. You are born again in the gateway to eternity, which is to be fully present, like all the mystics and saints have talked about. It doesn't have anything to do with the horizontal plane, but it does have to do with your willingness to give up the belief in the horizontal plane and then take the vertical plane of the present moment back to eternal life. So today's movie, I've said this before, but I'm going to say it again. Today's movie is the ultimate forgiveness movie. And I mean the singular ultimate forgiveness movie. I've showed a lot of movies, The Matrix, Truman Show, and everything, but this is, wow, you're in for a treat today. This is the ultimate forgiveness movie. Why is it so helpful? Because it's teaching us true forgiveness in the way Jesus wants us to experience it through his teachings in the Bible and A Course in Miracles. And most of us have been accustomed to thinking that we have to forgive people. But Jesus is teaching us that the whole world of time and space and the whole cosmos was made up by the ego. So when you forgive a person, when you try to forgive a person, like your mother, your father, or one of your children, or one of your relatives, or anyone in your life, your boss, any trauma you had, whether you believed you were abused, neglected, whether you were violated, whatever, and you think you're trying to forgive a person, but a person is just a tiny, tiny projection of the ego belief system. Like, if you look at planet Earth right now, there are like over 7.8 billion people on the planet. And you may think that there's some of those that you need to forgive, or maybe there's some that you have in your past that have passed away that you need to forgive, but you never reach the kingdom of heaven by forgiving people, because people are just tiny little projections of the ego belief system. And you have to forgive the ego itself. You have to overlook the belief in separation, not the projections of that belief. You have to actually overlook the ego to reach the kingdom of heaven. So that's why this movie is so good. This movie is going to take us symbolically toward the light. Most movies don't visually take us toward the light. This one visually will actually take us toward the light, towards a planet called Solaris, a kind of a planet of light. And this planet of light is symbolizing the light that is buried in our mind. Under all of our surface level perceptions, which we call the gross perceptual world of time and space, under that is our belief system. Underneath our gross perceptual world is a ring of fear, and that ring of fear is associated with our unconscious mind. And that unconscious mind is pushed way out of awareness. That's why you have to bring the darkness to the light. You can't bring the light into your perceptual world. You have to bring the darkness in your mind, what you believe to be there, to the light of truth, and it will disappear. And that darkness is covering over the light in our mind. And you might say that time and space in the cosmos is the sleeping mind's attempt to run away from the light. We have beautiful songs from Christian singers like Brandon Lake saying, you know, running to the light. And when we hear that song, ooh, we feel all the joy in our heart, running to the light. But the ego is not running to the light. The ego is trying to hide from the light, run away from the light, do anything it can to block the light. And, you know, we have a world now where, you know, everybody likes to use the word love. I love my husband, my wife, I love my partner, I love my dog, I love my children, I love my town, I love my sports teams, I love the Mets, I love the Yankees, I love, we have all the bumper stickers, but love is so far beyond awareness of this world that Jesus says in his introduction, this course does not aim at teaching the meaning of love because that is far beyond what can be taught. This course aims at removing the obstacles to the awareness of love's presence. So we need forgiveness. He's telling us right there, as long as we have obstacles to the awareness of love's presence, then forgiveness is our great need. Well, goody for all of us that Jesus has just dropped the ultimate forgiveness movie on us today. This is something you could rewatch with commentary 15 or 20 times easily and probably get new insights every single time you watch it. It's that deep. So it's very profound. All right, Jesus, thank you for giving us a movie that will help us with the Holy Grail that we've been seeking for millennium. We've been seeking this for hundreds of years. We've been seeking this for centuries, and today you're dropping the Holy Grail of movies on us, because no one reaches the light except by accepting the atonement, which is complete forgiveness. And atonement releases the inner light. So until you're ready to accept the atonement, the mind is just too afraid to accept that inner light. And this inner light is, Jesus calls it the great rays, he calls it revelation. And he says, if you experience this light directly, the body would not long be maintained. In other words, you wouldn't need the body. It would just kind of disappear from awareness, the consciousness, because you'd think, what's that? I don't need that. We have discussed recently, in recent weeks too, that most people feel that communication is limited to the body, but communication's of the mind. And there's one part in A Course in Miracles where Jesus says that a teacher of God could heal the world without a sound. Okay, without a sound. That must mean that words are not ultimately that important because they're sounds. That must mean that this light in our mind is so powerful that even music, which we all love, is unnecessary. Even words are unnecessary. Everything about time and space, the sun, the moon, the stars, the planets, the black holes, unnecessary, 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 unnecessary. That's how deep this movie is. When you start to go toward the light, you start to realize that anything that you believe that's an obstacle to the awareness of the light, anything that comes in between you and the light, is what you need to release. I think this is one of the best release movies I have ever seen. This movie is every 5 minutes on the screen, you feel like you're having to release something because that's how strong it is. It's like strong medicine. And so we're going way past our forgiveness stories today of trying to forgive people, people we believed wronged us, people we believed that mistreated us, people we believed did things to us against our will. People who need people are the luckiest people in the world. No, even past Barbara Streisand. We have to go past Barbara today because we've got so many stories and we actually feel that we have to forgive people. And Jesus is saying, people are thoughts that represent the grievances that you still hold in your unconscious mind. People are thoughts that represent grievances that are still held in the mind as unconscious. So we should be grateful for the people because they're acting out the part. They're actually helping bring what's unconscious into conscious awareness by acting it out. We should give them Academy Awards, Tony Awards, you know, all the ones that really were the villains in our life. Oh, bravo, that was the best villain scene I remember. Oh, Mom, when you did this to me, Academy Award for you. That was just fantastic. Dad, when you did that to me, that's an Academy Award. You know, we need to start to be grateful for the villain scenes because they were acted out to teach us what we still were holding in our unconscious mind. And then when we're grateful that they acted it out so we can see it, then we have to let it go. We have to say, all right, that's enough of that. You know, I don't really need this theater anymore. I actually would rather run to the light like Brandon Legg's song than be dinkering around in the movie theater of the past. But whether it's people that you still have memories of in your past that you haven't forgiven, or maybe it's people that are in your current realm of awareness that you're interacting with on a daily basis, and there's still certain things that annoy you, certain things that irritate you, pass out them Academy Awards. Every one of those annoyances, every one of those irritations is a death wish. It's coming from the belief that you can be separate from God. There are no annoying people. There are no annoying circumstances. There is nothing irritating about planet Earth. Nothing on planet Earth can be irritating unless you want to hold it down in the unconscious mind and then project out a world and blame the world, blame the people for your state of mind. You see how deep this is. Now, what's so good about this movie, Solaris, is Steven Soderbergh wrote the script to this. Thank you, Stephen. Oh my God, we needed this one for centuries. It's actually based on a book, and there was another movie that was from the book, and now this is like the second movie that came from the book. This is the Hollywood version. This is the Hollywood version where just to drive it home, just to make sure we can be free of special relationships forever. This is the Hollywood version where we have our lovers, George Clooney and Natasha, two beautiful human beings as the world would judge it, two gorgeous human beings who are going to come together. We'll see that through flashbacks, they met, they fell in love, and then they crashed like all of the human relationship seems to do. But it seems like she committed suicide after they had an argument about a pregnancy that she terminated without telling her partner, Chris. Interesting, Chris is one letter short of Christ. Isn't that symbolic too? The main character of this movie is Chris, and Jesus is trying to give us the final T, like, no, you had it wrong, Chris. It's just one more letter you needed there, and then you're home free. So what happens in this movie is there'll be a series of flashbacks. We're going to go to a travel to a far, far distant star, a distant planet called Solaris. If you just look at the title of this movie, Solaris, if you break up solar, the word solar means light, and is is. Light is. That's what Jesus is trying to tell us with the title. Light is. In the workbook of A Course in Miracles, I think it's workbook lesson 169, Jesus says, we say God is, and then we cease to speak. In other words, God is not reached through words. We say God is, and then we cease to speak. And then we pray, we go into prayer to be in communion with our Creator. So, since God doesn't have an ego, God doesn't understand words. But God is light, and God knows Christ as light. And for us to know God, we have to recognize that we are the light. We have to identify ourselves purely with light. Zero identification with body, zero identification with world, zero identification with time, full, total, absolute, complete, identification with the light. I am the light of the world. Not just as a cute phrase, but as an actual fact. That is an actual fact. I am the light of the world is a fact. Because it comes from God. Light comes from God. Light is God, and light comes from God. So this movie is going to start to help to dismantle all of our beliefs in interpersonal relationships. It's going to dismantle our beliefs in linear time. And you might say that the ego is very clever and sneaky. So the ego knows that in reality, there's one grievance, and that's the belief in separation from the Creator, the belief you can separate from God. But the ego invented linear time and space to dilute and disguise the one grievance, which is belief in separation from God, and make it into trillions and trillions and trillions of grievances that are perceived in the human condition. You see, that's a pretty sneaky diffusion trick, because if the only grievance is separation from God, and the ego doesn't want you to see that, because if you see that, you'll go beyond it, you'll just release it. But the trillions and trillions and trillions of grievances that we call time-space, with people, with governments, with the environment, with our neighbors, with our pets, all the grievances that we've had, those are just projections of the one grievance. And that's why we need a much deeper perspective of forgiveness than we've had. If we've believed that we have to forgive as human beings, and the ego is happy, it's like, oh, I tricked them. First, I tricked them into thinking they're a body. And then I tricked them into thinking they're a person with a private mind and private thoughts. And now I'm tricking them into thinking they have many, many personal grievances. And the ego's like a spider sitting back in the web just with a big smile on its face, because it is made such a sneaky, tricky, complicated web of perception that the ego's pretty sure in its mind that nobody will escape its prison. It's like, no one is going to get that deep to realize that there's only one grievance. But for us, good news is, after 2,000 years, Jesus found a way to get his book, A Course in Miracles, into the realm through Helen Schuckman. And now it's translated into 20-some different languages. And the ego, the spider is starting to shake a little bit now. Spider's like, uh-oh. They're starting to wake up. This is dangerous stuff. Because if the one mind wakes up, then the ego is out of business. You know, there is no separation in truth. So the first thing I think I want to do is, as we set this up today, is let's go over our movie poll results. This is the outcome of the movie poll, because this is what you ask for. And with these themes, you are now going to get. Jesus is like, all right, you asked for it. I'm going to have to drop the ultimate forgiveness movie on you if you're going to ask for these themes. You asked for it. First one, be convinced that no person or thought is outside my mind. Woo! That's the number one theme that you voted for. Be convinced that no person thought is outside my mind. Bravo, you all get the award for that one. that's a monster of a of a theme, you know. You're asking for it. The world may not look the same after this movie, but you asked for this. Just remember, you asked for this. Number two, healing happens through approach, not avoidance. So this movie is taking us towards Solaris today and actually toward the light. So if you feel uncomfortable, if you feel intense, if you feel resistance coming up, it's just because of one thing. It's just that we're going through approaching the light. We're going to approach the light today. Third one, allowing myself to face the deep feelings of emptiness within. Yeah, I think that's why many of us have sought for intimacy in relationships, because we have to face this deep feelings of emptiness within. You know, we're searching for connection. We're searching for intimacy. We're searching for a sense of love and oneness. And somewhere deep inside, we know there's got to be more than deep feelings of emptiness within. We've all felt senses of isolation, aloneness, like we're on our own, like somehow we're wandering on our own. And we want a sense of connection and love and intimacy in a very deep way. Heal my unbelief and the desire to exclude thoughts from your healing light. Wow. Heal my unbelief and the desire to exclude thoughts from your healing light. You know, the ego has tricked the sleeping mind into believing that it can love certain ones, certain people. That's why we even have a phrase for it. We call them loved ones. Loved ones. And then the rest, and then there's all the rest. Jesus is like, oh, come on. Don't think that God's love has loved ones, and then there's all the rest. Even in the Bible 2,000 years ago, occasionally I think the Apostle John would just rest his head sometimes affectionately on Jesus's lap. And then in the Gospel of John, which John purportedly wrote, he refers to John, the one whom Jesus loved. That's pretty cool. Write a gospel and say that you're the one whom Jesus loved. I think agape love, universal love, unconditional love is beyond just one person. But that always struck me as funny when I read it. I was like, ooh, the one whom Jesus loved. Wow, that's cool. Who wrote this gospel? Oh, John, come on. Don't think we're fooled by that, John. We know he loved everyone. Having true empathy and discernment with my thoughts. True empathy. That just means let me remember my real thoughts, God, the thoughts I think with you, like I am as you created me. I am as God created me as a real thought. I am spirit is a real thought. Help me remember those thoughts and then help me see the falsity of the rest. Like anything you can think of in time and space, that's the rest. Anything you can think of that involves the five senses, that those cookies smell good. That lake looks beautiful. That toe looks sick. whatever, any thought that you can come up with in your mind that's not eternal, I am spirit, I am as God created me, those are all the ones we're going to release. And that's why in this movie, even toward the end, it's so profound. It's like the deeper you go toward the truth, the more you can't really recognize the world. You start to see that there's a spirit that is everyone, everything. It is all encompassing, and the spirit is the truth. And anything that would block ourselves from knowing the spirit is what's false. So those are the themes. And since it's such a deep movie, I think I want to bring a few teachings from Jesus in to prepare us, because we do need to be prepared for this movie. Jesus even says this in the workbook of A Course in Miracles, and he says that some of the ideas that are presented, you must practice them because they are preparing you for a direct approach to God, a direct approach to the light. That's what the workbook is designed to do, prepare you for a direct approach to the light. But he's saying if you skip over some of the practices, that if you try to approach the light, and you've skipped some of the practices, then basically your experience of the light will be more traumatic than beatific, because the great fear is the fear of the light. So that's why we practice every day. That's why we practice forgiveness. We do the little incremental steps which will lead us to the success of being able to approach the light directly and having a direct experience of ourself as pure light. That's the whole purpose of A Course in Miracles. I was reading an article. There's Harvard University has been, for many, many decades, it's been doing happiness surveys every 2 years to find out what it is that really makes people happy. But the part of the study that I found fascinating is what it follows them all the way through their work years and into their retirement years. And the interesting thing about what they found in retirement was that the things that was most challenging for people in their retirement was the loss of their supportive and nurturing social contacts and relationships that people had spent decades preparing financially for their retirement, preparing for with health insurance and care of their body, and putting all this energy into that. But the one thing that people who were retired reported the most and said it was the least talked about was their relationships, that the connections that helped get them through all those years were gone. And then they really had to face isolation, emptiness, loneliness, because even their savings accounts did not help them. And even their health care and their life insurance policies did not help them then. It just shows that even for human beings, relationships are essential. Relationships are opportunities to give and extend love. And those are those little incremental extensions of love that are so important as you go toward the light. You'll be too afraid to approach the light if you haven't extended the light to the people that have come to you, that have been sent to you, that are part of your awakening plan. So here's what Jesus says in lesson 25. I do not know what anything is for. Purpose is meaning. Today's idea explains why nothing you see means anything. You do not know what it is for. Therefore, it is meaningless to you. Everything is for your own best interest. I mean, the only way that we could experience planet Earth and what we perceive in this world under the phrase, everything is for your own best interest, is we would have to admit that things that we're perceiving are not what they seem to be. The people aren't really people, they're just thoughts reflecting our past. The situations are not really situations, they're just thoughts reflecting our belief in and our investment in the past. This is a fantasy world. It's a world of fiction, and it's coming from our belief in the past. And the only way that we escape from this self-imposed prison of the mind is we have to start to realize that everything that we are perceiving is just a form of the past that we still are attracted to. We wouldn't keep perceiving it if we weren't attracted to it. We must admit that there is some kind of sick attraction to the past that is blocking us from remembering God in the present moment. So, if you meet something in this world and you're attracted to it, or you're unattracted to it, let's say you're repulsed and repelled by it, in either case, if you go deeper, you will see that you're still valuing the past because you're still perceiving something from the past. And that's why this movie is so helpful, because we need a larger context to understand lesson 25. I do not know what anything is for. And then the second paragraph, this is a really good one from Jesus. You perceive the world and everything in it as meaningful in terms of ego goals. These goals have nothing to do with your own best interest, because the ego is not you. This false identification makes you incapable of understanding what anything is for. As a result, you are bound to misuse it. When you believe this, you will try to withdraw the goals you have assigned to the world instead of attempting to reinforce them. Wow, that's a lot in chapter 25. It's basically saying that the sleeping mind it's hallucinating, it's schizophrenic, it's psychotic, it's neurotic. The sleeping mind, it's problematic. And he's saying, the problem is not what you think it is. The problem is just that you're sleeping. You know, if you wake up, it's all gone. You don't even remember problems. But as you sleep and believe in the ego, the problems seem to come on a daily basis. Here's another one, workbook lesson. This is a review lesson from an earlier lesson. I do not understand anything I see. How could I understand what I see when I have judged it amiss? What I see is the projection of my own errors of thought. I do not understand what I see because it is not understandable. There is no sense in trying to understand it, but there is every reason to let it go and make room for what can be seen and understood and loved. I can exchange what I see now for this by merely being willing to do so. Is not this a better choice than the one I made before? So he's talking a lot about seeing here. I do not understand anything I see. So everything that the five senses and the body shows us is actually, let's say it straight, it's actually incapable of truly being seen, because only that which is light and of light can be seen. Spiritual vision is the only vision there is. There is no vision in the body. This is idolatry. This is image making. This is what images are. They were made in hate, Jesus says. The world was made in hate. So when the mind falls asleep and the ego makes up a new version of seeing with the five senses and the body's eyes, it's artificial. You've heard of artificial intelligence. This is artificial seeing. This world is truly fiction. It's fantasy. It's artificial. It's not real. It's a trick. It's a disguise. It's a distortion. And what was then made invisible was the light. You see, now perception seems to take the place of light. So the only thing that can ever be seen is in light. And then perception is the attempt to make up something else to take the place of what can only be seen. Another thing, if we go back to the other one, I do not know what anything is for, lesson 25, knowing is of God. So to know God is to know heaven. It's to know oneness. It's to know eternity. It's to know everlasting life. And to know Christ is to know all those things as well, because God and Christ are one spirit. And that's what can be known. But once you start believing in the ego, then everything that can be known is now the unknown. And now every concern is about perception. Am I too fat? Am I too skinny? Did I eat too much? Did I eat too little? Did I have enough sex? Did I didn't get any sex? Did I get to exercise today? Did I get to rest enough today? Did I have too much sleep? Did I get enough sleep? It is bizarre. This world is bizarre. This world is a projection of error, and it's very difficult to try to be a human being when you're really a spirit. It gets to be very hard to be human. The more you come in touch with the light, you start to feel like I'm in a tractor beam and I don't know how this is going to go, but I'm running to the light because my truth is light. So you see, the deeper you go with spirituality, the goal is not to become a spiritual person. The goal is to let go of the personal perspective. The personal egoic perspective, that's the goal. That's what forgiveness is. Forgiveness just sees the false as false. It doesn't say there's more spiritual people and less spiritual people. There's more advanced spiritual people, the less advanced. I mean, if you go into the light, you're going to have to forgive all the avatars. You're going to have to forgive all the saints. You're going to have to forgive all the mystics. You realize if you're going to have to forgive all the parts, you're going to have to forgive all of the holy parts and all of the unholy parts. Hitler, forgive. Gandhi, forgive. Even in the Course in Miracles, it says about Jesus, the man was an illusion. How's that? Put that one in your pipe. Put that one in your pipe and smoke that for a little bit if you want to. You want to forgive someone, you're like, oh, come on, don't tell me I have to forgive Jesus. Forgive the flesh. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. That which is born of the spirit is spirit. This is like simple metaphysics, you know? Accept the eternal, release the temporary. That's in Corinthians. That's in the Bible. That's in Corinthians. You know, you have to embrace the eternal and let go of the temporal. Now, let's hear a pep talk about the light. Because if we're terrified, if we've been terrified of going to the light, maybe we need Jesus to give us a little bit of a rah-rah for the light. Let's give it a rah-rah for oneness, okay? Let's have a rah-rah for oneness here. Workbook lesson 169. Oneness is simply the idea God is. And in his being, he encompasses all things. No mind holds anything but him. We say God is, and then we cease to speak. For in that knowledge, words are meaningless. There are no lips to speak them. Boy, he's really giving us a rah-rah. There are no lips in heaven. Let's say a big cheer for that. There are no lips in heaven. There are no eyebrows in heaven. So there's never been any kisses or frowns in eternity. Let's just give a big cheer for oneness. Rah-rah. Okay, there are no lips to speak them, and no part of the mind is sufficiently distinct to feel that it is now aware of something not itself. It has united with its source, and like its source itself, it merely is. Now, that's a good rah-rah. And then he immediately says, we cannot speak nor write nor even think of this at all. That's his next sentence. After his cheerleading talk, like, okay. Now let's get back to it. It comes to every mind when total recognition that its will is God's has been completely given and received. So that's so beautiful. Only the creations of light are real. That's from the text, chapter 1. Only the creations of light are real. That's important because he's telling us nothing real can be threatened, nothing unreal exists. And maybe your mind goes, well, what's real then? Only the creations of light are real. That's the only thing worth opening to. That's the only thing worth giving your holy mind to. Is knowing yourself as a creation of light. Sometimes people ask us, if this is the ultimate forgiveness movie, then what's that say about the atonement? The atonement can only be accepted within you by releasing the inner light. Isn't that exciting? The only way you accept atonement is to release the inner light. Now just think for a moment, if you were going to release the inner light in you, you were just going to let it rush through you. Whoosh. Here's what I have to say to this world. Whoosh. Just a rush of inner light. The only way you can release the inner light is if you have no grievances, because this light is not destructive. It's not like you're going to release the inner light on your enemies, because Jesus says, you have no enemies. The light is who you are, and you have no enemies because you are light, and light has no enemies. Light doesn't destroy. Light doesn't compete. Light does not seek dominion over something other than itself, because there is nothing other than itself. Light is all. Light is everything. When we're watching this movie Solaris tonight, when we finally get to the planet, I want you to rejoice when you see this planet of light. I don't want you to tremble. Don't tremble when you come to Solaris. Just know, the end of the world is near. The light has come. Even in a movie I'm watching, I'm taking a long trip to the light, to a planet of light, you know, that's pretty good stuff. How beautiful indeed are the thoughts of God who live in his light. This is from chapter 3. Your worth is beyond perception because it is beyond doubt. Do not perceive yourself in different lights. Know yourself in the one light, where the miracle that is you is perfectly clear. And the last idea from Jesus, then I'm going to start talking about the movie. Good, this is from chapter 3. Good can withstand any form of evil, as light abolishes forms of darkness. Whew, isn't that lovely? Don't you feel the power in that? Good can withstand any form of evil as light abolishes forms of darkness. The atonement is therefore the perfect lesson. It is the final demonstration that all the other lessons I taught are true. If you can accept this one generalization now, there will be no need to learn from many smaller lessons. You are released from all errors if you believe this. Doesn't that sound good? Imagine you're in school and Jesus comes to you and says, here, I've got one final lesson, and if you can accept this one generalization now, there will be no need to learn from many smaller lessons. In other words, if you come to the light, you graduate. You graduate from the belief of time and space. You don't need to handle all these little mini grievances because they're projections. There's just one grievance that you need to allow be corrected, and that's the belief that you're separate from God. That's why his workbook lesson is, I am as God created me. I'm not a body, I am free. That is the lesson that takes up all the smaller lessons, because it's a lesson of identity. It's knowing who you really are. That is the point of all spiritual journeys, is to just remember who you are. Now, I will introduce the main characters of this movie today, so you kind of know who they are. There's our main character as a psychologist, and his name is Chris. He's only one letter short. He's just missing the cross. He's missing the cross at the end of his name. Maybe, and I think that's symbolic too, because Chris is a psychologist who doesn't believe in God. He doesn't believe in Jesus. And he could actually use the cross at the end. He needs that vertical connection to God and to understand the horizontal is not real. We have Rhea. Rhea is, we discover as we go into this movie, Rhea and Chris were married, and then he is dealing with the trauma. He's continuing on as a psychologist on Earth, but his trauma is that his wife Rhea got surprised and did a test, found out she was pregnant. Then she told Chris about the pregnancy, and he did not, and she terminated the pregnancy. And then when she told him, he did not react well. He was absolutely furious. And in fury, he basically left the house, and he was left the house in anger, and basically she said, don't go, I can't make it without you. And he basically says, you know, then you'll have to make it without me. He was basically saying these words and leaving, and in her distraught experience in that day, she commits suicide. So here's a psychologist who doesn't believe in God, but has this dark memory of maybe having abandoned his wife or rejected his wife or certainly left his wife in her distress of saying, don't leave, please don't leave, I can't make it without you. And he's got this buried in his unconscious mind. Of course, that memory is just a surface memory still, because deeper still is the belief that we could separate from God, that we could abandon God or reject God. That's the core issue. That's what the ego belief is about. And the characters in the dream just play out that issue in terms of abandonment, rejection, betrayal, you name it. So basically, we'll see flashbacks from Chris of his memories of Rhea. And of course, these are going to be very fearful and fear-based memories, because it's the memory that something has gone terribly wrong in the relationship, where someone in the relationship would commit suicide. Then he's going to go towards Solaris, and he's going to meet a character named Snow, another character named Gordon, and he's going to go up there at a request from his friend, dear friend Jabarian, who is saying, we don't know what's going on up here in Solaris, but we need your help, and I can't think of anybody that's better. So I'm asking for your help. So he's going there to try to be helpful, like on a what could be called a rescue mission. Now, this movie, years ago, someone asked me a question because I was showing a lot of movies. Somebody said to me, if I was stranded on a desert island, David, and I was dying, and I had one last request I could make for my time on Earth, and there was a capable for me, it was possible for me to watch a movie, what is the one movie of all movies you've ever seen that you would recommend as a last request? Like they do sometimes with prisoners who are going to be executed, you know? You get one last request. Well, if you're on a desert island and you're dying, and you are not sure what's going to happen, get to your nearest device, get to your nearest tablet, or if you're on a desert, you know, maybe along the beach, maybe you have to use your iMac or your MacBook Pro, that's better, and get to Solaris and watch this movie. This is your last request if you're dying on a desert island. I said that years ago. I think I'd say the same thing now. I'm not changing my mind. We're going to watch a movie that is would be a great last request movie. If you wondered, did I really accomplish what I wanted to in this world? Well, I don't know, but I did watch Solaris during the last scene. And I'm coming to Angel Gabriel, and he's like, Solaris? Oh, wow. We'll have to take that into consideration. Definitely take that. I'll get the other angels. We'll pool our minds on this one. So in this movie, there is a poem, that lines from a poem, a Dylan Thomas poem, that are repeated a couple times. And the title of the Dylan Thomas poem is called Death Shall Have No Dominion. Ooh, that's deep. That's the title of the poem. And here's four lines from it. Though they go mad, they shall be sane. Though they sink through the sea, they shall rise again. Though lovers be lost, love shall not, and death shall have no dominion. You see, this is a very hopeful poem, pointing us that the belief in death cannot hold us. We are creations of light, and the belief of death cannot hold us in its grips, because if we believed in it, we can certainly unbelieve in it. we can certainly unplug from that belief if we gave our mind over to it. So in this movie, Solaris is the representation of abstract love, abstract light, abstract oneness. It's like our symbol of God. And basically, as we go through the flashbacks of the main character, and both the main characters, both Chris and Rhea, his wife, will have flashback memories that will come throughout the movie. And these memories of the past are just our opportunities to forgive. They're not to try to figure out. They're just opportunities to forgive the past. And basically, we go through, we'll see the flashback of how these two lovers meet, how they come together and marry, and then Rhea's suicide and the intensity that they face. And so basically, this movie for Chris, the main character, and all the characters, and mainly for us watching the movie, this is our opportunity to start to release the past, to start to realize that the only way we reach true forgiveness is by releasing the past from our mind. It's not about necessarily forgiving people, because people are projections, but it's seeing that the people that we believe that we are or that we perceive are the mechanism that is going to be used to help us release the past. You know, I mean, most of us, when we think about forgiveness and releasing grievances, usually we're thinking about people. You know, usually we're not necessarily thinking about countries. You know, like, oh, waking up every day, I can't stand this country. I can't stand that they exist. You know, we're not so angry at the countries, and we're not so angry at different, you know, periods of time in human history or the history of the world. You don't wake up thinking, I cannot stand the Ice Age. I am so pissed at the Ice Age. I know some of you at the monastery are thinking that, but for most people on the planet, they're not thinking, I cannot stand the Ice Age or the prehistoric age. I can't stand the age of the dinosaurs. You know, no, our grievances are around people that have said or done things that we don't like. Or maybe we projected onto our own body in person, and then we think we've done things wrong as a person. And Jesus is like, no, that's not it. No, you didn't blow it. The problem was you forgot that you're the Christ and you were identified with that body. And because you were identified, you gave meaning to those behaviors. And then you gave false meaning to those behaviors, and then you felt terrible. And then it turned into a grievance. But that's not the main grievance. Those are just deflectors. Those are just ghost grievances. those aren't the real grievance. You know, he's like, don't worry about it. Here, come with me into the light, and then we'll see if there's any grievances at all in the light. The light is so powerful, and there's no thought of grievances or bodies in the light. So basically, one time I did write, think of it this way, if someone gave you a hot potato to hold, someone put a very hot potato out of an oven in your hand, what would you do? Drop it, right? Nobody, who's gonna hold on to a hot potato? You would immediately drop it. But we would drop it because cause and effect would seem to be immediate. Like if I hold on to this hot potato, I'm gonna get burned bad by holding on to this hot potato. The cause and effect would be immediate of the hot potato and the burn. But the tricky thing about linear time is when you have an upset, fear, guilt, pain, shame, when you have an upset and you project it to linear time, it gets diluted. It gets spread out over millions and millions of years so that you effectively forget the original upset and you get all caught up in dealing with the tiny ones. And so it seems to be a long and lengthy process to wake up from the dream of time and space. But what Jesus is doing with this movie is he's saying, do you want to come home? Do you want to come home with me? Because I'm home and you're home, and what you're dealing with now on a daily basis It need not be. You don't need to be struggling at all, because the correction has already happened and the light is truly the only thing left to, for you to remember. You don't need to remember scores for or study for exams in the world anymore. You don't need to succeed at relationship experiences. You don't need to succeed at experiences of jobs and careers. You simply need to be willing to face whatever you're experiencing in your daily life as just the, your great opportunity to let it go. Whatever annoys you about this world is your great opportunity to let it go. Whatever disgusts you, whatever you don't like about the world gives you a huge insight into letting go of the world. So I'm going to let this play. I'll come in and do some commentary from time to time, but this movie is a masterpiece. This movie gradually takes you on a ride where it's a ride of self-discovery. It's a ride of approaching the light. It's a ride of facing any obstacles you still seem to have in your mind that need to be exposed and released. And I think of it as like a, this is like an open-eyed meditation that you're doing with Jesus to clear the mind of everything that you still believe in that would block awareness of the light, that would block direct connection, direct identification with the light. This is an opportunity to come back deeper inside towards what I call communion. And communion is like the epitome of communication. If you think communication is important in this world, communion with God is so much more important than any of the words or any of the seeming expressions in time and space. But when we believed in separation, then the plan of separation has to be relevant and it has to be practical. You know, Jesus knows that there's a tremendous fear of a light and a fear of awakening. So we're given steps, and this movie is one giant step. Like Neil Armstrong, when he first put his little white boots down into the moon dust and said those words for the human race, one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind. Well, we're going beyond moon dust today. Watching this movie is just one small step, one movie workshop. But oh, for your mind, this could be one giant leap to remembering the light. That's my prayer. I hope everyone feels that. I feel like we want to be happy, right? We all want to be happy. We all want to be joyful. And our happiness and joy are in the light, in experiencing the light. So if you weren't a mystic before today, I can't guarantee by the end of this movie that you won't be a mystic devoted to God, because that's what this movie's about. So sit back and enjoy. Have a great time.